Well, yum, dessert. So, inshallah, we'll definitely be making that recipe. Thank you, Brother Bilal. And now we have Ramadan etiquette. We're going to continue that discussion with our lovely sister Masum. Assalamu alaikum and
Walaikum
welcome.
salam wa rahmatullah. Thank you.
How are you doing?
Alhamdulillah. How about
How's the
yourself?
month been?
It's gone so quickly.
Always does,
I
doesn't it? It's
know.
always the case you feel. But inshallah, Allah blesses everything you've done.
Inshallah.
I'm sure you've been very
Inshallah, God
productive
accepts.
and busy.
Alhamdulillah.
And even joining us, thank you so much. So we're going to be having a discussion on Eid, and it's often sort of one that we're so excited about approaching, you know, for very different reasons. Some people just relieved the month's over and you can start eating again, and some people are really sad, aren't they, that actually that the month is departing and they understand the blessings of this month that have been surrounding us. So from a sort of religious perspective, obviously, how do we prepare for Eid and the ibadah that we're supposed to do, and not just focus on the sort of, wow, we can eat what we want on that day, which is obviously the mercy from Allah as well. So maybe we can talk
I think
about.
if I pick up on what you said and just expand on that a little bit, I think it's really important because, you know, the first of Shawwal, Shaitan is freed, so he's there again. And he will get to different people different ways. Okay? So you'll have one extreme where people are so happy that the month is over. They can eat that, you know, that's all they're going to be focusing on. It'll be, and they'll overeat and they'll feel really sick because they haven't eaten, you know, like that for the whole month. And then all of a sudden they're, you know, sort of
Sugar
eating so
high,
much. Yeah.
and
So, you know, and they're going to lose out on the benefit of that day. And then you'll have the other extreme where you have those people who have really enjoyed the month and now are really missing it. And as you know, they're so down about the fact that, oh, you know, we were going to mosque every day, we were seeing everyone, we were doing ibadah together, and now we don't. And so the positive of the month has gone into this concept of negative thinking and feeling sorry and that pity of now it's, you know, gone, what are we going to do? So both extremes are wrong. If we can come to the middle where you're, yes, you're happy and you're sad, but neither one is overwhelming. So you're, and why are you happy and sad? So yes, you're sad because obviously the month of Barakah, the month where the doors of heaven were opened, the doors of hell were closed, where Shaitan was locked up, has passed. And that is a sad feeling. But at the same time, God is all merciful and he's still there.
Inshallah, he blesses us with another year.
Yes, inshallah. And we're happy because we have been able to fulfill that month. We've been able to complete that month. And hopefully, you know, we're happy because inshallah God has forgiven us our sins because we have done sincere repentance and he's accepted the fast from us and we have grown in this month. So we're happy from all of that.
And that's what you said in the beginning when we have the outcome of our fasting, and inshallah that is the outcome we achieve.
And if you look at again the verses in the Holy Quran, when God talks about fasting, he says that the purpose of the fast is so that they may gain taqwa. But when he talks about my Ramzan, he says with the month of Ramadan, so that they may be grateful. So again, it's, you know, that concept of you can only be grateful if you've actually achieved something. So if I've got the taqwa, then I will be grateful. And I will, you know, I will magnify God like he tells me to in the Holy Quran. So that concept of Allahu Akbar that you hear when you hear, you know, the Eid Salah, and you know, you'd actually do that from the heart because you can actually feel that taqwa, that closeness to Allah. You feel like you've got somewhere.
And I can imagine when you're sort of, you know, as a, you know, unified ummah, where you're all going towards, you know, that celebration. And what an achievement, mashallah, that we've got through this time, and Allah has given us, kept us with the health, made it easy, as you were explaining in the earlier mornings that we were discussing these topics, that it's, you know, it's something that we can't take for granted. And you know, he's taken care of us in this month. He's fed us, he's clothed us. We've inshallah been able to pay the charity and done the best that we can do. So when it comes to sort of, you know, celebrating Eid, well, even actually the night before, we were talking about Qadr nights, the night of Eid is very.
Yes, very. I mean, there are hadiths that actually talk about that it is just as important as the night of Qadr.
SubhanAllah.
So it's really
So not to
important.
lose that focus, is it, right to the end?
Exactly. So it's you know, realizing that this is the final night. You know, sometimes we don't realize it's the night of Eid till,
No.
later on, because obviously it's dependent on the moon sighting. So if we know that it is the night, actually make the most of it. You know, this is the final night.
How would they make the most? What would you say?
So you've got certain amals that that is recommended to recite. So you've got a 2 rakat salah, for example, where you're told to do 100 surah ikhlas. And again, from the fiqh perspective, just a little reminder that when you're doing the 100 surah ikhlas, the bismillah is part of the surah ikhlas. I know people who've started with the bismillah and then they recite the whole surah ikhlas and then they recite the whole without doing another bismillah. So each surah ikhlas has its own bismillah and that's really important to remember. Yeah. And if you can't do 100, do 10.
Mm.
Even if worst comes to worst, do one.
Utilize,
but at least do something. Yeah. You know, it's about doing something than not doing anything at all.
And it's so important, isn't it? Because, you know, I know in the subcontinent of, you know, South Asia, people have, like, you know, Eid night and they're putting mehndi and they're singing and dancing. And it's so, as opposed to what Islam is actually saying, you know, of course, celebrate. And then we can talk about how best to celebrate with families, but not to forget that actually the whole purpose was the elevation of the soul, wasn't it?
So. And it's exactly the same thing with the weddings, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's like you get so focused on the celebration of the wedding that you forget that the wedding is between, you know, the male, the female, and God.
Yeah.
And it's bringing God into the picture.
Definitely.
That then makes it a little bit more sanctified.
Yes.
Rather than just concentrating on the celebration.
Definitely.
So there's nothing wrong with celebrating. Yeah. But it's how you celebrate and make sure that celebration becomes an ibadah rather than just a celebration for its own purpose.
And call time to it, right? Not to be so, you know, not to have the celebration go out. Like you're saying, the extremities.
Yeah, it's about the middle ground. Yeah, Islam is all about the middle ground.
So in terms of, let's go the other way then sort of celebrating, how would you say is the best time? Is it obviously very family orientated, community orientated, perhaps the people that are don't have anybody to maybe invite them in. I mean, I know that reverts find it very difficult at times at Eid, don't they? That they're not really a part of a community or family, maybe on their own. So how best is it to utilise those sort of situations?
It's again, understanding the purpose of the Eid, okay? So Eid is where you now have, you spend the whole month reflecting, changing, implementing certain changes in your life. And you know, it's like you've graduated.
Mm.
You know, it's like that was the training ground, and you've graduated. And if you imagine in your graduation, who would you call? You would call those who you love to be part of that graduation, and you would also want to do it with your friends who have been doing the course with you. So it's the same sort of principle. On the Eid day, which is your graduation, you want to be with the family, you know, with those you love, and also with the community because you've done it all together.
Mm.
So it's about being an ummah as well as a family. But also, I think it's also sort of realizing that, okay, I've taken these steps. I know I'm going to need help because now, you know, shaitan's been unlocked. Yeah. The blessings aren't as much. It's much more difficult.
You feel it,
now.
Don't you?
Yeah, straight away.
Yeah.
So again, my family, my friends, you know, those are the ones I'm going to turn to for that support that I need now. And we're going to move closer together towards Allah.
And also that reminds me of the saying that, if you have good friends that remind you, family that remind you, and friends, obviously, they say the family we choose, but to actually make sure they're the sort of friends that don't just, you know, enjoy, they forbid us from the evil, you know.
Yeah, enjoy the good and forbid you from the evil,
So you've got that very valuable network of support.
Exactly. And I think maybe if we actually discuss with our family and friends the steps that I want to take, maybe then they can sort of, you know, just sort of prompt you when you're sort of moving away from that goal that you have decided for your own self. But, you know, a lot of the times, if we're accountable to another human being, it sort of pushes us to do it. I know we're always accountable to God, but I think we forget that.
Yes.
So it's really important to maybe sort of just share maybe some goals that we have.
Do you
for
think
the
it's
rest
like New Year Eve resolutions?
Yes,
so
exactly.
Perhaps like resolutions.
Yeah. And so those resolutions should have been made on the night of Qadr.
Yeah.
You've practiced them for the 10 nights that are there. And then
now it's
like, okay, now the training is finished.
The graduation. Yeah.
So if you think about it, it's like, you know, when you're going, when you're going to be a firefighter or a policeman or something like that, or a policewoman, you know, they don't put you into danger when you're actually practicing, when you're in the training ground. They never put you into danger. So it's like my Ramzan is our safety net. This is where our training happens. Where shaitan's locked up, there's no way we're going to, you know, be in danger.
Yeah.
And then once we're ready, which is on the day of Eid, it's like now you go out into the world and now you're, you know,
It's like a rebirth, isn't it? If you think about the mother's womb, you're just, you know, such a protection. Allah's giving you mercy. Everything's there for you. And then you're out in this world.
And now it's like you've got to fight. And you've got to be ready for that fight. And you need people around you to support you in that fight.
Definitely. And I think that's why it's very important to reach out to people that are isolated and perhaps don't have families around them, the reverts, that, you know, perhaps invite them on your celebration days and say, come and join our family and open your doors.
Because again,
doors.
It's about bringing the ummah.
Exactly.
You know, a lot of the times we sit there and we talk about the fact that we want the 12th Imam to come.
Yeah.
But until we're united, he's not going to come.
Yeah.
So by remembering those who don't have anyone and inviting them into our house, that's the concept of bringing that unity in and doing it together.
Definitely. It's you know, it's such a beautiful occasion. And even your neighbours, you know, just to say that this is what Muslims do, that, you know, I remember when we were growing up, yeah, it's, you know, our Christmas, but that's just the way they would understand it. But now, alhamdulillah, people are much more educated and they know.
And you have Eid cards now.
Yeah,
so you don't
definitely.
Even have to give them, you know, blank cards. You can actually buy Eid cards, which actually are very you know, so they'll talk about something that they can actually understand as well.
Definitely.
And I think, you know, we go out of our way to sort of, you know, give them Christmas gifts and celebrate Christmas with them.
Yeah.
So why can we not do the same for Eid, if not more? Because this is actually a celebration that is important to me.
Yeah.
So, you know, actually, rather than, you know, sort of celebrating the Christmas, or if you want to celebrate Christmas, that's fine, but ensure that you celebrate the Eid with especially non-Muslim neighbours. So, you know, just a box of chocolates or with an Eid card.
And it's a good opportunity to show your akhlaq, isn't it? Like you're saying that, you know, they have a positive image about Islam, to say that actually we are sharing and caring.
And it's a good opportunity for them to ask questions as well, because you're opening yourself up to sort of, okay, you know, this is our Eid, and they can ask you. And that's how then they will find out. And maybe you were the tool that God decided to choose to guide someone else.
Definitely.
And it would be through that guidance that that person may come towards Islam.
And often people learn through actions, don't they, of others, and something inspires them rather than, you know, necessarily sort of verbally saying, no, you must do this.
Yes.
That doesn't usually sit well with people,
no,
does
not
it?
At all. Not
so
at all.
As a last point, we've only got a couple of minutes left. So on Eid, would you say that it's a balance of sort of keeping things moderate and not sort of overindulging in the eating and sort of forgetting about the whole month that you've done, but sort of really focusing on sort of, yeah, well, okay, what have I learned? Where am I going forward for the year? And even the note taking to reflect from last year's what you learned, and perhaps the following year you can look back. I mean, how would you say?
Yeah, so all of those things are really, really important. The self-reflection is probably the most important thing.
Okay.
But then you also have certain things which have been recommended. So Eid namaz for the men, Zakat al-Fitr, which is wajib on, you know, the house, the person who's in control of the household,
the finances,
going to the graveyard.
That's something we forget, isn't it? People,
so remembering our loved ones who've passed away, and going to see family, and also maybe sort of looking within the community. There's lots of elderly people, as well,
lonely.
So maybe just going to visit them as well would be really nice, and doing it as a family. So, you know, again, teaching your children through action rather than telling them that this is what we should be doing, just saying, oh, you know what, let's go and visit this auntie or this, you know, this ma who's, you know, not got anyone. And sharing of gifts and things. And, you know, again, it's because we're celebrating, because we're happy, you know, the giving of gifts is much more rewarding than actually receiving it. So again, even if it is just something that you know, like encourage your children to make homemade things.
Yeah.
So it's not about the money that's spent, it's about the thought that
don't
goes
become
into
materialistic
a gift.
And ruin all our, but
so go, you know, it's a thought that goes behind a gift. You know, and it could be something that maybe could be something that is religiously orientated, which might help someone to sort of look at it and then move forward, continue moving forward in the 11 months. So there's lots of different things that we could be doing.
Yeah.
But it's about family, it's about celebration, but celebrating
everything, isn't it?
But celebrating, remembering that the celebration is about what we've achieved and continuing that rather than the fact that the month is over.
I think I've really enjoyed our discussions and come to the end, and it's been an amazing, you know, mornings that we've had together.
Thank you.
And I think the most, one of the things that we'll take away from what you've given us, Parsley Wisdom, is that put Allah in every thought and action so that everything is for Him. So that when we do it, we're not having any expectation we'll receive something, but we're just giving generously. And whether that's on the day of Eid.
It becomes ibadah then.
Exactly.
Every act. Because Allah says in the Holy Quran that He has not created jinn or man except to worship Him.
Yeah.
So every aspect of our life will become a worship to Him.
SubhanAllah. What a lovely point to end on. Thank you so much. And God bless you abundantly and infinitely. And inshallah, He gives us tawfiq to again sit and talk again. Inshallah. Pray for us, and may God bless you.
Thank you.
And that's all for the series. And now we're going to have little Abbas, and he's going to share us with us our daily hadith.